Hello, I'm Isaac Keller, founder, producer, and curator of the world's first AI-generated theater festival. What you're about to see is a piece of theater that was made in collaboration with GPT-3, one of the world's most sophisticated text-generating AIs. If you're curious about that process or why this festival is happening at all, there should be some links if you click up here on the little eye icon. And if not, just check out the entire channel. There are lots of interviews with these artists showing them experimenting with GPT-3 for the first time. There are 12 original AI-generated theater pieces. Check it out. And thanks for watching. Enjoy this piece as part of the world's first AI-generated theater festival.
Lights up on a large table covered with white cloth. A book and several pages of paper are scattered over the surface, along with writing supplies. In addition to these objects, there is also a briefcase on one side of the table. The president enters and begins working at that end, her head down as she writes furiously across countless pages. The double, disguised as a woman called the secretary, enters at the other end of the table and, finding herself alone in the room, begins to study an old book which was opened at that side of the table. There is plenty of light, but darkening sky visible behind her through one window. We know morning has not yet arrived. As she reads from this large book, it becomes apparent that she can see its faded letters more clearly than others could because they reflect off her belt buckle or whatever gaudy thing is covering it. When she suddenly notices the president sitting nearby regarding their surroundings with baleful eyes, the double immediately stops reading aloud so as not to disturb what appears to be a private time for deep thought before plunging into action or contemplation, and perhaps neither will ever happen again. For when confronted by something unexpected or unusual, our default setting tells us, be quiet, while our higher brain processes information about where we are and who else might be there besides ourselves. The president looks up from writing furiously across countless sheets of paper.
How long does early autumn last in Pittsburgh every year?
What's wrong with that?
The double stops reading when the president looks up and focuses on her.
What does Pittsburgh have to do with this? I'm in New York City now. What if you are actually sitting here thinking some of this happened in Pittsburgh? Can you see where I'm coming from?
The double looks at the book she's holding, which is open to a page headed Amnesty International. Immediately, her attitude becomes more conciliatory. She is still angry, but now it has become something directed at the president, and not just at the general idea of what she's reading about.
I'm sorry, you're right. I should have turned this page in my book before sitting down here to read it. It's been a while since we've seen each other, you know? I didn't even recognize you right away.
I thought you were my secretary. What kind of secretary are you if all the emails I've been sending to your office bounced back unread? And why would a New York City secretary wear white leather pants and an orange leather vest?
I know, I haven't been very good at my job lately, and it's caused a lot of trouble between us, but, well, you see this book here. It talks about something called Amnesty International. I can't stop turning the pages of it.
The secretary's assistant enters.
What am I doing? What's my name? How long has it been since we've seen each other, you know?
The secretary's assistant does not acknowledge the double at all, but begins scurrying around the table to take care of some tasks he assumes are now required by her presence in the room. The president, who is seated with her back to him, looks up over the top of what she has been writing and gives a damned if I know shrug in her direction. The secretary's assistant is holding the script for a play called Romeo and Juliet, not any real book that you might find in Amnesty International's shelf.
No, I don't know what my name is. Or who I am, or where I'm supposed to be right now, or when it will all end.
The two reporters enter.
I'm sorry, who are you? I don't remember having met you before. Do I look like your sister or something? Where do they find people like you in the city anyway? You're not even wearing a uniform, and it doesn't seem as if any of the rest of us can figure out who belongs where anymore. What about the White House? People used to say Air Force One landed there all the time. At least that's what Nixon said when he was president. And everyone knows LBJ used to hang around there a lot too, or am I confusing things now with what happened after Johnson? Secretary, where are those two bastards?
Lights shift, time passes.
Who are you? Where is everybody else? Why is everyone quietly working here as if we were in some museum on a Sunday morning with nothing to do but study the furnishings and wait for something to happen?
Just then, the lights in the room dim and a bright spot shines on the actor as she walks towards the table.
It's not me.
Hello.
Hello yourself. We are also here. No one said hello to us.
The double jumps up from her seat and begins to move about the room, marching and singing.
Swanee River.
She moves around the room, discussing what she sees. A large, interesting painting of two men playing chess. She also observes her body in the mirror and adjusts her clothing.
What are you doing here? You're not supposed to be here at all. When I arrived, there was a man.
I did not think this was a contest in which you had to be present to win. And, sirs, I am just as interested in what you have to say. Good day. I shall go back to where we came from, just before you publish your lies, which I know better than any of you will ever be able to do.
Wait a minute. Don't go away. It's not just for the fun of it that we are here together. We've come because someone else is also here. Someone who doesn't mind being in this situation where everyone tells lies to get what they want.
Hello, this is us. We are the truth tellers. Can we ask you a few questions? If it's not too much trouble, can you tell us your name? I am Ernestine Douglas Wilson. I was born in the year of the horse, and I have withstood several storms, but have never had umbrellas placed under me, because my skin is tough as leather. Don't bother telling me anything about myself that I do not know, and don't try to get closer than 3 feet away from me, or else believe me, and don't believe it, that's up to you. You just better be careful about when it comes to when your months are moving around too much for people like moths trying to find a way out of an attic at night before they become prisoners in one for all eternity. Pardon me for this speech.
The actor exits hurriedly to the back of the stage.
Don't forget what she has just told us. We won't. Thank you, madam. Good day, and thanks for stopping by. Goodbye now. Pardon our questions, and don't mind if we keep them in mind as long as it takes us to find out where they come from. Bye-bye, then. Thank you so much. We'll be seeing you again soon enough before we start writing about you in a way that is not very nice at all. Not that we have any reason not to like or respect you personally, but there are more things to think about now. Say, what time is it? I'm awfully late for my appointment.
Reporters 1 and 2 exit hurriedly. The actress enters and moves around the room, doing a sexy dance. She says her lines as she dances. The double stands in front of her, trying to get her attention.
Look! There are 3 men at the table where you were sitting before who look just like us. One is older than we are, one looks like a father image but has no children, and the other seems very young, as if he might not be able to decide whether or not he wants a child. But why did they keep you from going away?
They didn't keep me from going anywhere! They just don't know how to let you go once they've laid their hands on your body in little secretive places that are more trouble for them, believe me, than they want them to be. I'm tired of being a plaything for people who try a little too hard. This afternoon, I will visit my friends and ask them what should be done with those men, the ones who thought it would be fun to put all kinds of toys between us until we've forgotten where our bodies even come from anymore. You'll see, brothers. Some man's day is coming when he won't want anything inside him at all but the blood running through his veins. That's what I hope will happen for all of us.
Are you sure they really want to be that way? Do men like a challenge in bed, or do we have such an easy time with women so much that we take them for granted and then turn on them when their bodies won't give us exactly what it is we think they should give us? If my mother had told me more things about her real life instead of hiding everything underneath the rug she didn't want me to see, maybe I wouldn't treat some woman whose body turns me on with such disrespect because she might laugh at my jokes or feel sorry for someone who seems lonely, you know what I mean?
What kind of woman do you think I am? Are you a man, or are you just trying to hide your real self behind something that is not as strong and deep inside yourself as it should be for a person who looks like he's gotten by with everything all these years? And now has no one to change for anymore? Since he thinks he knows exactly where his soul is located in relation to every other part of him, including the lining of his own coat pockets. Do I look like someone who would sympathize with anyone except herself? Yes, that's me, a mirror reflection without any feelings at all about anything but her own glistening cheeks and those of the people around her.
Why are you crying? You're a strong woman. I wish I could be like you with no one to turn for except myself. But if I gave up today, maybe tomorrow would never come. And what good is tomorrow without some kind of past behind it? Without someone or something we can cling to even when all else has fallen away from us and our bodies have been left completely alone inside ourselves? Don't cry. don't make me feel like everything bad that happens in the world is my fault, because after a while, this terrible sadness takes over every part of my mind and leaves nothing but emptiness inside, which makes life so hard to bear.
Blackout. Scene 2 lights up. The three men and Ernestine enter. They are dressed in drag. They see the double and the actress, who look like the secretary and an actress from Amnesty International. They are plain themselves, but have some funny quirks to them. A case of mistaken identity that is really done on purpose, because it makes things funnier. While wearing this disguise, they will talk about how important the human rights cause is to them, without knowing who else has joined their cause today for any reason whatsoever. But when these two people realize that not only do they know each other, but haven't seen one another for many years, a very strange thing happens, which leaves everyone present completely shocked into silence, except out loud, we should show our feelings with lots of laughter from all sides.
Hello, Ernestine Wilson. We haven't seen each other in a long time. I'm not really the woman you think I am. In fact, I might not even be human at all, and have come to this planet from a very different place than the one you thought I've been born into. Or to do God's work on Earth for someone who has been reserved in heaven above, just to make sure that everything is going to be as it should be down here below, where we live our lives together every day of our total existence. Listen, don't tell anyone what I've told you, but soon many people will want such awful things done to their bodies that they will take away everything else inside them and start doing terrible things.
What do you mean no one should tell anyone anything? Even among ourselves, whatever that means. I don't think we're right for each other. And who's to say what terrible things people might want done with their bodies nowadays anyhow? Is there such a thing as too much sex or not enough when it comes down to some of the terrible diseases floating around out here in the open air where they can attack our nervous systems on purpose by making us believe all kinds of strange ideas about love and life itself? Surely you know I'm not feeling love inside myself these days without a second thought given toward whether or not anyone else is doing the same thing.
Do you want to hear about the time I almost got married to a man who's really dead inside and is just pretending to be me, but no one can see that because of some terrible disease he's been living with all these years? But when they take him over into surgery where they cut his eyes out from the inside of his head, there will be nothing left for any doctor to cure except for what might have come alive again. If only we had been alone together somewhere in our own private place without anyone watching us every step we took towards each other, or listening to our innermost thoughts as if they understood everything we were actually trying to talk between ourselves. So let's go now and talk about how bad everyone else really is without doing one single thing to stop them in any way, since they all have their own power and we only really care about our own feelings. And they don't understand how to feel anything at all except some beautiful thoughts running wild through their mind with no one really paying much attention to you. I mean, who are you?
I can't believe it. You're here too? Now, everyone who has something terrible done with their bodies will help me get out of this place where there's no love allowed, because if things like that are happening everywhere on purpose, we wouldn't ever be able to live outside ourselves when there is no one left inside to say a word in our defense, when no court can hear our case against ungodly behavior that only leaves its victims dead inside. What have we really got left when all these things happen to us on purpose? You see, this is all very serious business. Now, I should go because there are other important things waiting for me outside this prison/hospital called New York City.
Exit.
We never had any idea anyone would come along who didn't know the truth about their own bodies so they could set them free into some kind of open air where everything was allowed without any reason or logic at all except love, which has not been around since God fell asleep on the job, so we shouldn't be surprised by anything anymore. I don't feel like talking about sex all day long, since it seems to go against everything I really believe in.
The telephone rings.
We're not here anymore. I have to go do what they expect me to do for them. Go on the stage where someone is waiting for me, because my plans will be ready by tomorrow night, when the double goes into all of their lives and destroys every bit of love left in anyone's soul until there's no one left at all. Now, it's time to start everything happening fast, so we can get rid of everyone who has done this terrible thing with their bodies and anything else they want as a result, with the help which comes from being prepared beforehand. So you see, there are no words anymore between us now when it's too late for private dreams or even any kind of self.
The telephone rings again.
So whoever answers the phone had better have a very good answer for everything that's just happened, because we're not prepared, and by now, whatever this is about shouldn't really matter to anyone anymore, come wake up time in the morning when some of us can go back inside ourselves only, while others must stay dead on purpose.
We don't mean no harm, that's for sure. We only do what they want done with their bodies, after all. So it won't be easy to ask any questions without getting us into trouble right away. If you believe anything at all about that kind of thing happening out here in the open air between us, you might as well go ahead and kill yourself first, because no one will remember your name after I'm done with you. And for the rest of our bodies, they can do anything they want to now, since they're not really alive in the same way that we are anyway. Having some ideas about why things happen out here so words can't say a thing anymore until I put an end to every free thought left inside your head. It's too late for any kind of life when everything has been destroyed on purpose by someone who doesn't believe in what anyone else thinks or feels at all anyway.
They exit.
Who was it? What did they want? Everything's supposed to be ready by tomorrow night when the double turns into something other than human. What about all that has been done with their bodies towards the end of this very same day after what has already happened here in New York City, which was not meant to happen at all? Isn't that right?
To get rid of any feelings inside our life. But there must be another way to release anything else left between us besides doing it on purpose without having a single idea about why we do the things we do for anyone who might come along from out of nowhere afterwards and suddenly see how impossible tomorrow morning will become.
Everyone notices the pistol hanging on the wall.
No one really believes anything like that will ever happen to them.
The pistol falls to the floor. Whiteout, the end of Act 1. Act 2, Scene 1. Lights up on the president and the two reporters who are trying to get an interview with him.
Mr. President, if you can spare a minute. I'm in my office right now, so please come in soon as you arrive. I have some very important news for me, too. You see how we've never met before this day, even though it's always been true that your words have meant something different than what happened everyone else would say when they mean from outside of nowhere about everything that happened here in New York City? But today will be completely different than anything which has ever happened here before, because all of these things are completely true about what happened to those people from out of town who don't know how to say anything anymore. But everything did happen here in New York City just yesterday, so I'll wait for you here while the two reporters try getting someone on tape before it's too late for them to do whatever has been expected all along, long ago. What kind of world is this anywhere where we're supposed to be so afraid without having a reason why certain things have already happened? Because they want us all killed off for not saying anything back when there were still some reasons left inside of our heads, which never really happened at all, but made us think that way instead. The government has always believed what it wanted, and now no one wants me around anymore either, because everything we've ever thought about turning into some kind of different place to live seems like it never really happened at all, but only for us. So what is there left inside of our heads which never really seemed so true?
Yes, the president has entered the premises and should be here any minute now, though he's already talking right in front of the two reporters from out of town. They don't know that yet, so I'll let them get on tape some things that they want to say before it's too late again. They're saying things about their school years because they had a very bad time while growing up with other kids who didn't have anything better to do than make fun of them sometimes, especially when those same two reporters had to try finding out some things on tape when they were back in New York City before it's too late for them again. But now that the whole thing already happened just like this yesterday, all of those same two reporters want us to listen carefully because there are still a few good people left over who can say things about the president and how he took away one man or another from out of the town using American soldiers as his way of taking care of business outside. Then came along what was supposed to be the last night of Broadway musicals. Thanks very much so far. And if everyone says yes, then we'll have something different than we've ever heard before.
Oh, I'm sorry. My name isn't the actress. It's Ernestine Douglas Wilson. I'm the secretary's assistant.
End of play.